Laura Pandith was a State Department special representative to Muslim communities when Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State. She's now an advisor for the nonprofit Counter Extremism Project, and she's in our studio. Farah, welcome.
Thank you so much.
A lot of people in this country just don't get it. I mean, would we compare this to a cult? I mean, but I don't know of any cult that goes around beheading people.
So, you know, when you think about ISIS or Al-Qaeda or Boko Haram or any kind of extremist group, you have to look at the ideology that they're pushing forward and how it appeals to young people who are finding it very attractive. Your piece that just led into this segment right now talked about the sort of propaganda machine.
But what's attractive about it?
It's more than propaganda. You know, what I did representative to Muslim communities was travel around the world talking to Muslim millennials and traveled to more than 80 countries around the world. And the single data point that was consistent from Argentina to Zanzibar was that these young Muslims are going through an identity crisis. And so when they're asking questions about culture versus religion and how to be a modern Muslim, the loudest voices out there are the voices of the extremists that are pulling them in and giving them a definition of what they're supposed to be.
What are they giving them?
They're bringing them in and telling them that they can belong to something bigger than themselves, that they can be part of an organization that is doing something, in their view, noble. And this corrupt ideology can only be dealt with counter efforts against the ideology.
But is it about religion or is it about them finding their identity?
So they're using religion as a tool to lure them in.
So talk a little bit, if you would, about how sophisticated this is. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're using offline and online attempts to reel these people in. It's mostly men, right?
No, it's men and women. You're seeing
but
more and more.
But mostly men, right?
It is mostly men. But what's really important and pivotal is that there's been a change in the game. You're seeing all female armies of ISIS. You're seeing all female armies of Al-Qaeda. You know, last week, the reporting of the two young girls from Austria who were teenagers who left home to marry these people who are fighting in Syria. They're now pregnant, is the reporting that's come out. And you're seeing a new incarnation of this fight. So you have to look at both how Muslim millennials are being lured in, both men and women, online and offline. These are digital natives, and so they're connecting ideas around the world.
So how does the U.S. fight it?
The U.S. government can fight it in a lot of different ways, but more importantly, what we have to do is to lift up other efforts around the world, both in the private sector and in the public sector, nonprofits, foundations, that can think about what's happening at the local level, and that's what the Counter-Extremism Project is all about.
Yeah, I mean, we talked to a number of experts who said lately that ISIL has provided them a vision. The wrong vision is the one that we see. I don't know what vision they're seeing, but that they need another vision to counter that. What vision should that be?
There should be many different options for these young kids to find alternatives to the alternative of extremists. And the innovation and the creativity that comes to the table online and offline has to be outside of government. It has to be tools such as sanctions and looking at where money is coming from so that these groups go forward. It has to be counter-narratives online and offline that are bringing the kids at the very local level away from those that are preying upon them. The Counter-Extremism Project is one important effort towards that end. It's a bipartisan effort that is seeking to expose the architecture of support for extremist groups and extremist ideology.
But these are young people who want to leave the United States. They want to go to the caliphate, right?
These are young people, both in the United States and all over the world. Let's not forget that this is a global pull. This isn't just about foreign fighters coming from the U.S., as important and urgent as that is for our country, and it should be. But the fighters that are coming in from Europe, Malaysia, Australia, all over the world, what is appealing to them? What is drawing them in? How can you have people as diverse as somebody in Australia and somebody in Morocco finding something in common?
But they're not worried about getting into trouble, are they?
In terms of what?
Well, I mean, being arrested and thrown in jail.
That's not what they're looking at. They're looking at this sense of ownership over something that they can do with their lives that is going to give them purpose. It's a corrupted thought process, no doubt about it, but it is appealing to them, and the bad guys are being very savvy about how they're bringing in those young people to be part and to build their armies. The thing is, you can't have armies if you don't have recruits. And in order to look at how we deal with ISIS or Boko Haram or Al-Qaeda or any of these extremist groups, you have to go to the sourcing of where they're getting
recruited. I understand that, but you could be describing African-American men in New York City today, but what's different about them is they're not Muslim.
What's different is that there's not a powerhouse that's funded at the levels of ISIS and others that all day, every day, have a message to them online and offline that is pulling them in. And any nefarious group that's able to do that has the ability to win. It's the money. If they didn't have the money to do this, if they didn't have the recruits, they couldn't reach out to them. They wouldn't have the machinery or the infrastructure to be able to do it.
Farah Pandit.